फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक। फ्रॉम टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू सी जेपीए। आई थिंक इट विल बी अ 3 to 4 सेशन इन द जेपीए पार्ट। ओके, टुडे इज द स्टार्टिंग सेशन ऑफ जेपीए। वी विल सी व्हाट इज अ जेपीए एंड ओवरव्यू ऑफ जेपीए। सी, जेपीए इज अ स्पेसिफिकेशन। देर आर मेनी पीपल कंफ्यूजिंग व्हाट इज जेपीए। दे डोंट नो द आंसर व्हाट इज जेपीए एंड व्हाट इज साइबरनेट। ओके, JPA is a specification. Hibernate is a ORM tool. We have a Hibernate, TopLink, iBatis. This framework or ORM tool framework. Okay, using this framework we can manipulate the database. Okay, that is the use of ORM tool. Okay, this ORM tool may have many things, but I want to use a certain thing only. I want to use some common functionality only. I don't want to use everything from Hibernate. I don't want to use everything from TopLink and iBatis. So for that, JPA come into the picture. JPA is a specification. It has some specification. That specification only we are using. We are using to manipulate the data from the ORM tool. For example, our application nothing but a Spring Boot. Spring Boot app calling the save method, read method from the JPA. This will call actually implementation from the ORM tool. That is the Hibernate. In our case, Hibernate. That can be TopLink and iBatis. Why this requirement? Okay, for example, today I'm using Hibernate. Tomorrow I want to use some other ORM tool. In that case, I can easily switch one ORM tool to another ORM tool without doing any changes. That is the advantage here. Okay, so I hope you understand what is JPA and what is a Hibernate. Hibernate is a ORM tool to manipulate data from the database. JPA is a specification, that specification implemented in the ORM tool. We are using a JPA, the Spring Boot directly using JPA. From JPA we will invoke the method from Hibernate. Okay, whatever method we are calling from JPA, that method invoked from ORM tool. That can be Hibernate, TopLink and iBatis. This is the concept of a JPA specification. Okay, okay, then in the Spring Boot, the great feature is a repository object. Repository object is a very, very powerful feature in the Spring Boot. We don't have to write many code to handle DML operation. DML operation means data manipulation. To work with the database, we don't have to write any additional code. It's the repository classes, repository interfaces are make our life very easy. Okay, we'll see that when you do the implementation. Before exploring this diagram, I give a simple demo by mapping MySQL database table to in our Java classes. Okay, might be I given this example in the previous class when use H2 in-memory database, but definitely that is different from this. Is that particular example I used a very high level. Okay, but I can, from here I will go little bit in depth so that you can understand something new. You can learn something new. Okay, now we're going to see one small save operation using a JPA repository by mapping our Java object to MySQL database table. After that, I will explain this. Okay, I have already created a project called billing system. The billing system, it has one controller and one service class, one user service class, then three entity object: address, base object and the user. Okay, I want to show this simple example using address and the user object. Let's explore about the user object. See here, the user object having email, first name and last name, then address list. User can have a multiple address, that could be a residential address, office address, etc. So that I mentioned address as a list object. Okay, this is one to many feature, one to many relationship. That is one nothing but the current class user. User is a one, many nothing but whatever object list you declared here. Address list should be many. Okay, then here declared email first name and last name. These three attribute properties mapped with the last name, first name, email column in the database. When you look at the database, I don't have any table created now. Okay, whenever start this application, Spring Boot will create this table. Whatever column here mentioned, that column will created in user table. Here I am not mentioning any primary key, right? Here, when you look at here, extend base object. Base object is a common object for all the entity object. Okay. For example, if you look at the base object, here I mentioned one column called ID, rec ID. That rec ID mapped with rec ID in the as a primary key. Then deleted mapped with the is deleted column. Date created mapped with the date underscore created. Date modified mapped with the date modified column. Okay, now these four attributes common for all my POJO object. POJO object nothing but a entity object which mapped with the database column. Okay, so for example, if you don't have this base object, this four attribute I need to declare all the POJO object. Today I have address object and user object. Tomorrow I may create another object, right? Another entity object, right? For that entity object also I need to declare that. I don't want to do that. I want to reuse this attribute across the entity object. Okay, that's the reason I'm making one base object. That base object I moved all the common attributes. When you look at this method, I annotated with mapped superclass. If you say mapped superclass, this particular base object act as a base class, then whatever attribute I defined here, that column part of the column of child object. Let's say user should have a email, first name, last name. Apart from this, that user table should have a record ID, is deleted, date created, date modified. Okay, this column applicable for all the child object of base object. Okay, so through this I can avoid the duplicates. Okay, this is one of the best practice. Then all the entity object I mentioned add data. What is add data? Using add data annotation, I don't have to create setter and getter method. Okay. It will automatically, it will taken care by that add data annotation. That add data annotation coming from this artifact. Lombak is a library. Using that library, we can avoid to create a setter and getter method by manually. Okay, this will taken care by Lombak taken care of creating a setter and getter method. So just you have to mention add data, that's it. This object mapped with the user, address object mapped with the address table. Okay, now in that user object, in that address table, I want to add one more column called user object. That user that mapped with the user, that user column I am saying as a user ID. That user ID is a primary key of my user column, my user table, that is coming from here, rec ID. Okay, I am mapping here. Apart from that, I am creating address 1, address 2, address state, country, landmark I am saying nullable equal true. I can add so null value here, and address 2 I can add null value here, so nullable equal true. So this is a simple mapping with one to many relationship. Okay, with one to many relationship. Now I want to create these tables at the time of starting the server if table is not created in the database. For that, the application YAML file, I am using application YAML file here. Say here DDL-auto equal to update. That meaning whenever any changes happen in your POJO object, that will be automatically reflected in database table while starting the server. That is the purpose of this attribute, this particular attribute. Okay. Okay, now I hope you understand about the POJM mappings, that is entity object mappings. POJM nothing but it's a plain old, 1 minute, sorry guys, I forgot that. Okay, POJM meaning POJM. Yeah, POJM object meaning is plain old Java object, plain old Java object, that is a entity object. Now, Hibernate perspective, they will say all entity class, they will call it as a POJM, plain old Java object. Okay, I forgot this name. Okay, okay, going back to example. So we have mapped that our entity object with user and address, mapped our entity object database table. Now going back to service class, repository class, going back to repository class, user repository. When you say user repository, this is the interface user repository, extend JP repository. There are multiple repository interface available in the JPA. Those are used for specific purpose. Okay, here I am using JP repository. When you click the JP repository, you can see find all and find all by ID. There are many methods apart from save and save method. It has many methods, save all, save and flush, delete batch, delete all batch. There are some additional advanced methods that exist in the JPA repository. Then JPA paging and sorting repository. This JPA repository coming from paging and sorting repository. This purpose of this particular repository class is, if you want to do pagination, if you want to do sorting mechanism, we have to use paging and sorting repository. Since we are using JPA repository, we can use this function, whatever function we have, we can use. Apart from, we can perform paging and sorting mechanism when using the JPA repository. Okay, see here, find all, this is a page, pageable, sort. This purpose, using this classes, we can perform sorting mechanism, pageable mechanism. I will explain you when come to this topic. Okay, then if you look at the paging and sorting mechanism repository, it's extend from CRUD repository. Extend from CRUD repository. CRUD repository is another repository classes. Is it used for only CRUD operation? When you see here, we have save method. Also, we have some find by ID, find all. Mainly CRUD for doing the CRUD operation, save, update, and delete. That is the purpose of the recent CRUD repository. Apart from CRUD manipulation, JPA repository having some additional methods, additional advanced methods. Paging and the sorting repository having only for sorting purpose. Okay, if you are using CRUD repository, we cannot perform paging and the sorting mechanism, because this is not extending from paging and the sorting repository. This is directly extending from repository object. This is the parent repository interface from all the repository interfaces. Okay, so now we are using a JPA repository, right? In our user repository. So since you are using JPA repository, JPA repository coming from paging and sorting repository, paging and sorting repository coming from CRUD repository. So I can use this save method in our user repository class. Using user repository class, I can perform a save method. Now I don't have to write any code, just I can call that method in a service class. I already created a service class. The service class, I defined auto-wired user repository. Inside the user repository, inside the save user method, I am saving the user repository.save user. Now after saving the user, that return new user object. That new user object I am returning here. Then user controller, I am calling the save user. I am calling this whenever save user, it will go on to save the user and return a new user information along with the primary key generated information. This user does not have a primary key, right? So whenever after saving this new user having a primary key of the req ID, then address object req ID, the full information will come here. Okay. So I am passing this user object as a request body. When you look at the user object, it has a email, first name, last name, and address list. Now I want to construct a JSON file, JSON request body file for this object. How to do that? If you are finding difficulty to construct, you can use this method here. I created one util method. This util method, this is the main method, standalone application. Using this standalone application, I can generate a JSON from the particular Java classes using the object mapper. I am doing that. See here, user, your new user, then address and new address. I'm addressing some value. I'm setting some value in address object. Then initializing the address list. I'm adding that address to the address list. Then this address list I'm setting to my user object. Okay. Now, whenever say object mapper write value as string by passing the user object, this particular method return a JSON string equivalent to the user object. Okay. Let's run this program. What's happening? See, the JSON string is generated here, right? Now I'm going to format this. There are many JSON viewer in the online. You can go and format it. See here, req id, email, first name and the last name. Again, req id. req id is a primary key. Address 1, address 2, city, state, country. The address 1, address 2 only I have given value in the code, right? So that value is coming here. So I have created a JSON request body. Now I need to use this JSON request body as a request in my postman. Go to the postman, create a post method api/users. The method is api/users. When you look at this controller class, api/users only I am using. Then go to body, just copy this request body. So since the req id is a primary key, I don't have to use this. Also in the address object, I don't have to use this. Suresh at user don't have to do that. Okay, this is the address attribute. I want to insert, if you want to insert address record, I need to pass this information to the address table. If you want to insert user data, I want to pass these three attributes in the user table. Okay. Okay. Now, whenever send this particular request, it will come here. It will come here. And I'm passing this user information to here, right? When you look at the user information, what is there? Whatever value I'm passing here, that value mapped here. That value mapped respective field. Also, you are passing address list, right? This is the address list. The JSON, I am mentioning this address list as array. Okay, this particular thing will go under mapped to address 1, address 2, city, state, and the country, landmark, mobile. The user, I don't have to mention here because once user table created, user information created, automatically Hibernate add that user ID in this column. Hibernate. Okay. Okay. Now in my database table, I don't have any table. Just I created a entity object, right? Just I created an entity object. Now I'll go to start my application, Spring Boot application. Let's see what's happening. First, it will go and create the table. I want to do a run. See the console. Look at here, log, it's creating a table, right? Creating table, address table, creating user table. Then it's creating a one joining table also. Create table, user underscore address list. It's creating one joining table. Since it have given a relationship, it's creating one joining table. It has a user ID and a user ID primary key and address ID primary key. For both the table, we have a req id as a column, right? That's the reason it's saying user underscore req id, address list underscore req id. Automatically, it's creating. Okay, now we'll go and check the database. Address table, you have all the expected column. User ID is a foreign key that is coming from user table. That is a req id. req id. See here everything. See here date created, date modified, is deleted. These three attributes coming from where? here also you can see the date created, date modified, is deleted. These three attribute coming from a common object called base object, right? I am using this is the common object. This applicable for all the entity object that I will going to create. Okay, now this is the time to save the record in user table as well as the address table in a single call. I already prepared the request. Now I'll going to send a request now. Let's send now. What happened? I think my system is too slow some reason. Yeah, this is the response I got, right? See here. I'll little bit moving up response section. The response section, see, created one record for user table, that ID is a one, created one address, created a one record in address table, record ID is a one. For both it's creating a one. Then these records are inserted successfully. These records are inserted successfully. That's the reason I'm getting a response. When you look at the code after after creating a after saving the record, I'm returning the saving information, saving user information here. That information I am returning back to the controller. I am returning here. That user object I am binding into my response entity. The response entity I am passing this newly created user object with the status code created. That is the reason it's coming. Status code created. That response is coming here. Let's check the database now. See here, user is created, if deleted equal to 0. 0 means the record is not deleted. If it is 1 means the record is deleted. Then if you see the user table, record is created, right? This particular table automatically created by JPA. Joining table. So user ID record is 1, address ID is a 1. It's automatically created by Hibernate. You don't have to worry about that. Now our intention is completed. User also able to user and address table, we are successfully saving the record. Okay. See the application YAML file, right? This I'm not saying about the configuration part, sorry for that. In the application that YAML file, the server port is 8080, Spring application is a billing system. This is update DDL, if on auto means automatically get the table if anything happened in our entity object. This is my database URL, username and a password, the driver name. If you want to work with MySQL, don't forget to add MySQL plugin, MySQL artifact. Okay, MySQL artifact. I think I explained this already. Long back, using long back, we can create the setter and the getter method automatic at runtime. We don't have to create a setter and a getter method in the compile time. That is the purpose of long back, that task performed by at data annotation. Okay, friends, I am stopping this session here. The next session we're going to see more about JPA. Okay, please subscribe if you are not yet, share this video to your friend circle, click bell icon for regular updates. Thank you so much for watching this full video. Until next video, bye bye from Suresh K7.